My co-driver Dick Johnson was very good, and he still allowed me to drive with him in 81, where we won the race together.
Three.
You can see all this on who?
Super 100 MPH.
You can see all this on Super 100 MPH.
Hello, thank you very much for joining us this week for another action-packed episode of Great Moments from Bathurst. Following his tragic luck in 1980, many people would suggest Dick Johnson's victory the following year was a deserving reward for the battler from Queensland. In 1981, Johnson teamed up with the highly underrated John French to give Ford its first victory at the Mountain since 1977.
Australia, I'm Mike Raymond for the 7 Network. Welcome to our telecast of the 1981 James Hardie 1000 Classic from Mount Panorama at Bathurst. Well, Mount Panorama, of course, is situated 160 kilometres west of Sydney. The circuit is used by road motorists going to and from work each day, but twice a year it's used for racing. Once at Easter, of course, for motorcycles, and the long weekend in October, of course, for the James Hardie 1000 Classic. $100,000. As we wend our way down towards Pitt Strait, a reminder that Channel 7 will be bringing the action. We have 150 personnel here. We have 23 cameras, two in the sky, two in cars, and of course you'll be able to see the race from every possible angle. It promises to be a remarkable race in that Australia's world driving champion, Alan Jones, is back from Europe. And Australia's third place getter in this year's Indianapolis 500, Vern Schupen, is back too. And to complete with Quinella, Derek Bell, the co-winner with Jackie X at Le Mans this year, is also lining up. The teams have been preparing here for over a week. We have an enormous crowd here present for what promises to be a race that there is no clear-cut favourite.
At the front of the grid, for the second year running on pole position, we've got the 9 Camaro with Kevin Bartlett and Bob Forbes. Alongside them, the Palmer Tube Mills Falcon with Dick Johnson and John French, car 17. Then on the second row, car 05, Peter Brock and Jim Richards, winners for the last 3 years in the first of the Marlborough Holden dealer team cars. And then in car 7, Bob Morris reunited with John Fitzpatrick in a Falcon. On the third row of the grid, the big surprise packet, car 43, the Peter Stuyvesant Mazda RX-7 with Alan Moffat and Derek Bell. Alongside them in a Commodore, Gary Rogers and Clive Benson Brown. The next car is the Cadbury Schweppes Commodore of Peter Jansen and Larry Perkins. Then we've got the second of the Marlborough Holden dealer team cars, 25, with John Harvey and Vern Schupen. Another Camaro, car 21, Ron Dixon and Bob Stevens. And then a Commodore, Garth Wigston, and the youngest driver in the race, Steve Harrington from Tasmania. They're the top 10 qualifiers for today's great race.
While previous Hardie Classics have always attracted top international drivers, only three, in fact, have made it to the winner's rostrum at the end of the day's racing. The first was back in 1966 when Finland's Rano Altonen finished first. Then, of course, it took 10 years later to 1976 for John Fitzpatrick to nurse home Bob Morris's ailing car. Then in 1977, Jackie X came to town. The former Le Mans winner went on to win the race with Alan Moffat. Well, Jim Richards, of course, an expatriate New Zealander, but he still calls Australia home, has paired with Peter Brock to win the last three classics. Let's take a look now at the international drivers who will be participating in today's James Hardie 1000 Classic. Heading the list are two Australians with winning credentials, World Formula One driving champion Alan Jones, who teams with Warren Cullen, and South Australian Vern Schupen, third home in this year's Indianapolis 500 in the United States. England's Derek Bell, co-winner of the Le Mans 24-hour Classic this year, teams with the Alan Moffat Mazda Challenge, while the 1976 winner John Fitzpatrick of England is back to partner his friend Bobby Morris. The United States is represented this year by oval track whiz Rodney Combs of West Virginia, while CBS network commentator David Hobbs of England will certainly feel at home in the Alan Grice BMW. New Zealand has a strong contingent of drivers this weekend. Leo Leonard, the sports sedan king. Bathurst regular Rod Coppins, Formula 5000 racer Graham Lawrence, and newcomer Steve Diamond, who was also raced in the United States. Japan is also represented by the factory Datsun combination of Hasima and Horishino, two honourable gentlemen keen to do well. So there you have it, a full field of internationals for the 1981 James Hardie 1000.
This is the Channel 7 race cam camera mounted in Alan Grice's JPS BMW. Co-driver, David Hobbs from Great Britain, a commentator with the American CBS network. David, you've seen this before, but it's the first time you've been in the seat and doing the commentary as well.
That's right. I'm really looking forward to it, Gary. It's a tremendous camera, this, that Channel 7 has invented over here in Australia. It really is the first all-singing, dancing, acting camera. I mean, it does the whole deal. It can zoom in on me, it can zoom in on the feet, on the instruments, look out the front, it can swivel around, look out the back, and of course, as I say, it can focus, all done from the truck, which is the first time this has been done. And last year, or during this year rather, 1981, we used this camera in the stock car race at Daytona in the 500, and it was tremendously successful, and of course, it really came into its own for the Charlotte 600, when Buddy Baker, driving the camera car, got involved in an accident, which he managed to miss, that we saw it all happening in front of him through the screen. Then the camera did a quick 180 and we watched all these other guys crashing into the wall while Buddy was still going on, and the whole thing was shown live. It was tremendous.
Well, we might see some of that today, but I hope you're not involved. How difficult is it going to be doing both jobs, driving and commentating at the same time?
Well, Buddy didn't speak. I've done quite a bit of commentary for the CBS network and people tell me that my mouth never stops and I drive passably well. Whether I can do both together, we're about to find out today. I think it's going to be very difficult, especially up on the mountain, because there's a lot of action there. The road is narrow, it's very twisty, and there's going to be a lot of cars out there, 60 cars in the race. So there might be moments of sudden silence when the old voice is going to just suddenly dry up.
Do you have any preconceived ideas about the sort of things you want to try and tell viewers?
Well, I want to try and, if we're catching up with people, I want to try and point out, say I'm having a dice with somebody, I want to be able to get to a situation where I can try and explain the tactics required to get by somebody that's either very equal in time or even possibly just a little bit quicker, to try and talk people through that manoeuvre. But of course, to do a thing like that sometimes requires a hell of a lot of concentration and I might not be able to pull it off, but that's the sort of thing I really want to do. Obviously, then there's the ordinary run-of-the-mill coming to the pits and, you know, we're going into the pits now and Alan's going to take over type of deal.
David Hobbs and one of the race cam cameras that will be bringing you the action from inside the cars during today's James Hardie 1000.
This is Kevin Bartlett's pole sitting lap yesterday amid all the rain, the slush running across the road. It requires very few words from Garry and myself. Just listen to the engine rev as Bartlett goes up, across and down the mountain. Just incredible. Here he is coming in to complete his one lap that was to give him pole position and a titch under $10,000. This year's James Hardie 1000 contestants come from many walks of life and from many and varied lands. But perhaps one of the most colourful is American oval tracker Rodney Combs. Combs has been to Australia twice previously, but they've been for oval track performances. He won the rich $27,000 Marlborough Sedan Grand National at the Liverpool Raceway earlier this year. And come October, we now find Rodney Combs at Bathurst going circuit racing. A new experience, Rodney.
Yeah, very different.
What have you found? What's been the hardest thing to contend with since you arrived at Mount Panorama, with the exception perhaps of the right-hand corners?
Well, first of all, they didn't tell me it was asphalt. It ain't no dirt out there, but No, it's really different. Shifting of the cars, I guess, and being on the right-hand drive really is no big problem, but the shifting the cars, braking, and doing it in the right spots of the track. And I started out, you know, not real slow, but I started out slow and took my time and worked myself down real well. So they're tickled with me, and at least, you know, they say I'm the fastest American's ever been around the track. So Rutherford's been here and a few other ones, so that makes me feel good.
The base difference between the Commodore that you're sharing with Paul Golson and one of the Pizza Hut Camaros that you'll be driving in Australia later this year?
Well, the wheelbase is a little bit different, plus we're allowed a little bigger motors and fuel injections, and our car is a lot quicker. Probably our car coming off the mountain would probably run 220 mile an hour and probably be off the ground about halfway down, but it's a lot of fun, and the car is going real good, and, you know, I'm just tickled, you know, how I'm running.
Tell me this, I don't think it would be unfair to say that you've had very limited circuit racing experience, left and right hand corners. Do you find this more of a challenge than any of the big races? This is something a little different to do?
This would be a challenge for anybody. Probably a lot of people thinks that, you know that I come over here just thinking it's a road course and it's a little deal, but I tell you what, it would be the Indianapolis at home, and I feel probably a lot of them over there, when they get up the top of that mountain, they might turn around and come back the other way.
Well, the good old boys that you run with in NASCAR back home, would they ever believe that you're in Australia driving Australia's premier road race in company with Australia's world champion, Alan Jones?
Well, that's what I say, you know, it ain't no little deal. I mean, you got the Australian champion, he run all over, and he was a world champion, so it ain't nothing to do with little guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, start your engines! We have touch-off for the 81 Hobbs 1000. Johnson and Dick Johnson of Queensland, who leads from Kevin Button going into the first turn, and just look at that wall of cars. All trying to find a way around that corner. 60 starters as they go through the turn. Let's make sure incident-free first corner.
Johnny Harvey's made a great start, slipped through inside of Bobby Morris and is up in fourth place behind Johnson, Bartlett, Brock, then Harvey, then Morris.
Standing on the gas, Dick Johnson, but Bartlett is coming to him as they speed up Mountain Straight.
Up the top, up the mountain, across the top. Bartlett was enormously quick up there in yesterday's runoff.
Dick Johnson is the race leader. In second place, pole sitter Kevin Bartlett, and Peter Brock is the... Now down through the tricky, the torturous part of the racetrack. Working away hard is Dick Johnson. He's running for broke out in front. Here's Johnson. Now the brake duel. Whoa! Not much between them. There was almost a touch.
Johnson's over the strip on the inside.
Boy, Dick Johnson wants to lead this in a hurry, and Brock says, let's make it three wide and have a real race of it.
Brock takes the inside run. Well, Johnson's lost out in this battle. Bartlett maintains the lead. Brock is through to second.
Okay, Brock is now going to put the pressure on. I think Brock wants to get up there in front and run. Johnson says, hey, I was up there a minute ago. He's going back after it. The comparison of speed along going up the mountain straight between the Ford and the Commodore. Up over the top of the mountain. Kevin Bartlett in the Camaro. And right on his tail is Peter Brock. Going to put plenty of pressure on Bartlett and see if that thing can stop and run strong. Bob Morris, meantime, has moved up a little closer to Dick Johnson. So we have a Camaro, a Commodore, and two Fords in the top four. This is pretty racy stuff in the opening laps. Kevin Barton is attacking the first five laps as though he was going for pole position again.
After two laps, Laurie Nelson's complete pits. Jeez, look at his nose to tail, and Bob Morris is slipping right into the back of Dick Johnson.
We have a tremendous race going here for the lead. I think Brock is getting a little agitated, just wants to harass Kevin Bartlett a little more, see if he can force him into error. He sat in behind. Look at Bartlett leading left and right down Conrad Straight. He should have the long legs over Brock, but we'll wait and see what the braking is like when they get to the end of Conrad Straight. I'm quite surprised that Brock, in fact, is staying with Bartlett. Here he is pulling out. And now going to race Kevin down. It just takes him very quickly. That was what Johnson tried to do, but got a fender caught in there at the same time. So, okay, a few laps down, and you listen to the crowd are up because it's Brocky coming from behind and the Commodore that takes Kevin Bartlett. The crowd goes wild along pit straight. Bartlett's still in second. Johnson is third. Bob Morris is fourth. Garry Rogers fifth, and sixth place is held by John Harvey.
2:22.57 was the flying lap time for Kevin Bartlett last time around, despite the fact that he got nutted right there at the bottom of Conrad by Peter Brock. Brock leads up the mountain. Bartlett in hot pursuit, and has he got the power to... Oh, he might lose out on the corner here, I think. The right-hander.
Look at this.
There's a definite touch. Bartlett's lost something.
Dear me. They're attacking this like it's the ovals at Talladega.
Right here and now, most people's predictions have gone out the window.
Have they what?
They said Brock wouldn't be able to keep pace with Johnson and Bartlett in the early laps.
Okay, Brock. Oh, dearie me, Brock, I think has got problems, has he? He's pulled to the outside, and Bartlett, Brock is, I think, in trouble. Yes, he's been passed by Kevin Bartlett. Goes back into the race lead. Johnson is in second place.
Bobby Morris third.
Peter Brock comes into the pit area, and certainly an unscheduled pit stop. What it looks like along pit straight. See the crowd off to the right, absolutely packed here today. Now the left-hander. Okay, that's through Hell Corner, and now they head up Mountain Straight. The next turn will be a right-hander. That's a GTX bend.
But Datsun seems to be slowing.
Here Peter Williamson talking. You can see Terry Lee and our chopper off to the left. as we head up now to their next corner, which is GTX. We'll drive you around the circuit and show you what it's like. GTX right-hander. Now, once again, steep climb up to our next, which is the cutting, of course. Through the cutting. Here we go now. Through the left of the climb. Once again, up the top towards Reed Park.
Watch that needle climb.
Keeping an eye on the tachometer. Six. Wow!
Hello, John Harvey, and goodbye.
So if you thought you were running quick, he's running away from Williamson. Okay, across Reed Park.
Williamson might...
Anyone down at a Castrol? If you've been eating bacon and eggs in Western Australia, stand by. We're going to come over the top of the mountain, down through McPhillamy to Skyline. Down through the gears. Left. Right. Left. Right. A left. Another right. And down through the gears to this gradual left-hander that gets very, very touchy as you come out against the wall. And you're back on Conrod Straight. There's one lap with Peter Williamson. Okay, troubles will it be for Kevin Barclay? Wait to see. Yes, it looks like Kevin Barclay is coming into the pit area.
It's just a complete and utter amateur nincompoop got in the way and turned right, just turned straight across my path, put me straight into the fence, and I took him, mate. That guy has to be black flag. I'm going to punch him in the mouth when the race is over, and that's a fact.
Bartlett went in with a broken wheel by the look of it early in the race, and Johnson is looking very strong out in front. I've been hit twice at the start.
Peter, yep. Mike Raymond in the tower.
Yes, Mike.
Are you satisfied with where you're running at the moment? Everything running just properly as you had indicated before the race?
Hang on a sec.
Sure.
Yes. No, we're quite happy with the position. I've got to watch my front tire. I tend to do 60 laps without a stop. Oh, with the fuel stop running. Oh, look, oh. Holy cow, that's stupid.
Yes, we'll edit that.
Oh, gee, that was fine. Anyway, I got a bit of a task in front of me because that's the Japanese totally supported entry that's leading us. In fact, there's more Japanese in the pit down there than there was in Okinawa in 1944. I feel a bit like John Wayne. Remember the guy over the top?
And there is our race leader. I think it will be a happy day for all our viewers throughout Queensland with Dick Johnson, the man from Prudential, leading this quite nicely. We mentioned the problems that set Johnson last year. At this stage, the problems, and every race leader so far has had big problems, not Dick Johnson. He still has a good lead over John Harvey. As you can see, Dick Johnson, watch how he closes. Whether or not he takes him before Forest Elbow, we'll wait and see. There he is. That'll give you an idea of just how quick, in fact, the little Toyota Celica is down through the mountain. But as soon as they reach Forest Elbow, where they are about ready to reach now, you'll now see Dick Johnson with the booming V8 move to the outside and effect a pass. Here he comes. Wow. And we pan around as Dick Johnson takes Peter Williamson. Hello, he's not driving 25. Oh, as Johnny Harvey has come into contact with a car and is attempting to climb from the car.
Well, the car's going to lose his door if he doesn't shut it in a hurry.
Harvey is anything but happy about this arrangement. The other driver comes across the road. You'll see, dearie me, what wretched luck there. Harvey tells it all by throwing his gloves on the ground. The other driver involved comes up and throws his gloves on the ground.
Williamson, foot flat to the boards across the top of Skyline. Now coming down into the S's. Right on the tail. The speed shop car. He wants to get back to the shop and pick up a little more the way Peter Williamson's nudging him. And you wouldn't believe it, on lap 44, car 44, spins off.
There's the view outside with all the marshals just trying to dig the sand out of the trap to enable him to get back onto the racetrack again.
Well, you got a four-wheel drive. A moment of some history is taking place at the moment, because for the first time ever in this race at Bathurst, a reigning world champion is about to go out on the track. Alan Jones being strapped into the cockpit of car 12.
There we see the car with our Formula One world driving champion, Alan Jones. Don't take too much away, because when they came into the pits with Warren Cullen at the wheel, they were in sixth position. So there's still a long way to go in this great race. As you can see, Alan Grice is pitted. I think he'd be in no mood to do any driving for a moment or two after being caught down in the bunker. David Hobbs, of course, takes over the car at a critical point of the race. He settles into the car. We'll be getting some pictures from him later. We'll let him settle down for a number of laps, and then perhaps for our American viewers taking in our telecast through the CBS network, an opportunity for David Hobbs, commentator, to also be race car driver and tell us what it feels like. Okay, getting going. So we might follow this just to have a look at the familiarisation lap for David Hobbs. Keeping in mind he hasn't been out there, just taking the car over. Surf and turf for the BMW today. Well, David Hobbs has taken over the car. He's made all the adjustments, the mirror, the seating position. There we can follow the car going up into GTX Bend, right-hander. David Hobbs, a vastly experienced driver, drives for BMW North America. I've already made mention of his broadcasting ability with CBS Network in the United States.
Alan Jones, Mike, has completed only one lap of the circuit. It took him 3 minutes and 39 seconds to do so, and he's back in the pits.
Dear me, everything just seems to go wrong. So they're back in. We'll follow first lap in a bit with David Hobbs over the top of the mountain. Love the circuit in practice. And what a practice they had. It was blustery and blowy, and then, of course, qualifying yesterday in practice in the rain. Well, that's the scene. David Hobbs has taken over after Alan Grice has climbed out of the quicksand.
Alan Jones, what's the story?
Well, when I took over from Warren Cullen, I think previous to that, a piece of the airbox, the aluminium piece, had fallen in front of the radiator, and the car had been running very, very hot. In fact, this was what accounted for the unscheduled pit stop earlier in the race. And I think because it was running very hot, and on top of that, the oil pump belt's broken completely off, and we had no oil pressure at all. So it's lunged itself, I think.
You're out of the race?
I say so, yes.
How do you feel when you come so far for such a big race and have such a short drive?
Well, I'm not far from home.
You've had a rotten season.
Well, I've had better, that's for sure, but, you know, that's the way it goes. I had a good season last year, and this year I've had a lot of bad luck, but, yeah, that's motor racing. It's man-made and it's mechanical. I mean, you put those two things together, anything can happen.
But surely it's a greater disappointment when you're the world champion and so much more is expected of you.
Well, I don't think it's any greater disappointment because I'm the world champion. I think it's a disappointment for the team, because probably there's a lot of expected on them. The pressures are on their shoulders to supply me with a good car, and I feel sorry for them, I really do.
And I think we could have a pit stop on the cards for Dick Johnson. We might time that. This is an extraordinarily long pit stop.
Dick Johnson, hair wet with perspiration. We'll bring him over to the camera now. Dick, that was a long spell at the wheel and a long spell in the pits.
Mate, that was stupid. You know, they should have just kept going. There was nothing wrong with the thing. It's only an oil leak when you stop the engine, because it's just got, on the inlet side of the oil pump, it leaks. But when it's sucking, it doesn't leak a drop. They buggerized around here and tried to fix it. Well, you know, that's just a waste of time. The rest of the car is absolutely magnificent.
Follow this, because this could well be the pass that determines the outcome of the race. John French. Shot showing them coming through the mountain, coming up to lap one of the slower cars. And French is particularly fast over this part of the track. The slower car pulls over to the left. Gives the front-running two drivers the opportunity to pass with safety. This is where the V8s really stretch out. That will give you some idea of the speed across the top of the mountain. And he is now getting close. Really close. John French starting to dial in on John Fitzpatrick for the lead. The James Hardie Classic. Can he do it on Conrod Straight? We'll have to wait and see.
Well, it'll be interesting to watch them first of all to see whether there's going to be driving skill that gets passed. It's Fitzpatrick versus French down.
most powerful car. Okay, there we have it, the leader, John Fitzpatrick, and pulling out to effect a passing manoeuvre is John French for Dick Johnson. Pulls down the left-hand side of the circuit, two Ford V8s, and now we have the race lead change effected.
Frantic wheel change, car 7, the Morris entry having just lost the lead on the track to the French Johnson Falcon. Bob Morris, of course, now out to try and regain that situation. Tyres are changed, Morris is in the car, and he's off. You didn't make any, didn't do anything silly to try and stall off Johnson's car when he came up onto you then?
No, they were going faster, they're quite a bit faster on the straight, and there's a long way to go. It'd be stupid to try and win the race at this stage.
Of course, this year we welcome viewers across the United States on the CBS network, and David Hobbs, of course, that we mentioned before, a broadcaster for CBS with their motorsport. We have David Hobbs in the pits, and for viewers of CBS across the United States, perhaps David would may I like to have a chat to you.
Well, I don't want to disconcert Alan too much at the moment because he's just catching up with that bunch of backmarkers as he comes into the braking at the end of the straight up over this lump. There's the final crest, and just before that crest he's going to have to brake pretty hard. And if you look closely at the ground, you'll see two long black marks, there they are, disappearing to the right down the escape road. Well, those are marks that yours truly put there 3 laps before I made my pit stop. So Alan's got his hands full coming in there, and he's still catching up with these guys. I can't see who they are. But is the car operating okay now, Alan?
Yeah, the car's fine. It's, I don't know if you had a problem with brakes or anything after I gave you the smouldering thing, but whatever it was, you've certainly resuscitated for me. The car is just hasn't got a problem. It still tends a little to lock its rear brakes up. But I left the sand iron in the pits on this occasion, so I won't do that to you again.
Well, the car was fine when I first took it over. There's a nice aerial view of you now, Alan, going through GTX, so I'm watching your line. I'm the new boy here at Bathurst, and Alan, of course, has driven here many times. Coming up to the cutting, this is the slowest point for us on the course, down into second here, and it's a bit of a lug round that tight hill, and it's quite a steep hill here. But Alan, he seems to be doing it right to me. He's keeping the right line. He must have been watching footage of me in the car. This is the bit I don't like, coming up into this left dip where Alan just gives a bit of a lift. You can hear him just come up a little bit, but he's making a lot of ground on those slower cars now. Down into second as he comes into the dipper. That's where John Harvey came unstuck earlier on in the race. Coming into the elbow and out onto Conrod Strait, where Alan again is going to get up to about 160 odd miles an hour. What a gaggle of cars there. There's the Ford. He's just about to overtake that Commodore. Nowhere to go. This is sort of a difficult situation for Alan to talk to us now, because he's got to lap that Commodore. As you can see, he's been really using the draft. American viewers will understand that fully who are used to watching NASCAR racing. But they're both catching up with a gaggle of cars in front. These are all quite fast cars, these passing now. These aren't the slower back markers. These are guys that Alan's happy to work hard to get by. Because the next car in line is one of those Ford Falcons, which has got about another 100 horsepower. You can see the car weaving just slightly on the braking there. A couple of Fords which initially up through the cutting here should out accelerate him.
What about the extraneous traffic on the circuit?
Well, it's very bad. I said early on in the broadcast when I was out in the car, I don't know whether you've got it or not, that it's more like an obstacle course than a race course, because that damn truck keeps coming out. And as Fitzpatrick said earlier, you know, it's caught between a rock and a hard place. You can't leave the cars out there, and yet that truck itself can become quite hazardous. And They warn pretty well, you know, there's the white flag, the marshals show the white flag, which is a slow vehicle on the course, and then they have the pace car following it slowly down the road with its flashes going, so it gives you some warning, but it is a bit dicey, especially along the top.
What's your impression of the James Hardie 1000 as a motor racing event?
I think it's tremendous. It's it really is an event, and I think that racing the world over has got to realise that there's more to racing than just cars. And the James Hardie 1000 is really doing a good job. I mean, it's a proper event. There's thousands of people here. They can camp here and make a long three-day weekend. And of course, the racing, which is tremendous. And this is very like American stock car racing. The viewers of CBS who used to sing the Daytona 500, the World 600 from Charlotte, will readily appreciate these cars, although these are even more stock than those. I mean, these really are stock cars.
The most critical pit stop now for Dick Johnson. And, of course, for John French.
John French not going to get out of the car, Mike. He's staying in there. So I think that maybe he's checking another stop then, because Dick Johnson would certainly want to do the most belly in the car. But French is staying in place, so it suggests it's a very brief stop. I don't think Dick wants to lose more time in the pits. Just fuel, they check out the tyres, a quick sip of a drink. John French takes a cut lunch with him as well. He eats food as he chugs along. There's a bit of sustenance. That was a quick stop. He's out. Car 17. Johnson French car on 170 laps and only 38 seconds behind. Dean Morris, Patrick and Colin. So two Fords up front. Moffat and Bell a lap behind in third place in the Mazda RX-7. Derek Bell driving at the moment. Gary Rogers, retired Benson Brown, back into first place now since Ralph took over. As we were saying earlier, doesn't quite have the experience of Bathurst as Gary Rogers, and so the car has dropped back a little bit. And it'll be a big effort as far as Gary Rogers to try and pull back a little bit of time. Alan Brown from Victoria, the recar car, and the Tasmanian, Tony Edmondson. They're up there in fifth place, ahead of the... That's an extraordinary result, isn't it? Number sixth place, the Falcon of Joe Moore and Christine Gibson.
I got it. All right. Track's blocked.
We have an enormous traffic jam. We've had a horrendous crash at the top of the mountain. By the look of it, Bobby Morrison, number 7 is around sideways, 57 is there, one of the recar team cars. We have an absolute blocked track at the top of the mountain.
There's a view from Alan Grice's car, he's there, car 44, he's just stopped. He's not in damage, but there are a number of cars. Bob Morris's car is there, Bob Morris going so hard trying to get up the lead in second place. Car 4, the recar car, Alan Brown and Tony Edmondson is involved. There's another one there, looks like 57, a little hard to pick from here.
The race at this stage, as you can see, has stopped. Bob Morris, who was running second in the race, is one of the drivers involved. We've had absolute drama here. The track is completely blocked. A replay of it for you.
Well, Christine Cole is involved. She was very early there. You can see Christine on the left. Bob Morris came along. He spun there, the car going backwards. Christine was involved first with another car. There are cars on the other side. Alan Brown, one car just coming in the back, slowing down. I think it might be David Selden on the far side as well in the smaller car. Let's have a look at that again in a little while. We can, Mike, just to try and pick up who got into shop. And Christine Brown, Christine Cole, as she was, Christine Gibson now certainly involved. I think she's okay, though, kids at home who are watching this race, I know. Track is blocked. Not all those cars are involved. The leading group, but there are about five cars caught up there. Now here's Christine. You can see there, there's flame from the back of a car. A flash there. There's a little bit of petrol or oil spills there. Christine's car spinning on the left. Bob Morris's car shoved through by the car behind. He spins around and comes across onto the left-hand side of the track as other vehicles come pouring down towards us. 57 certainly is there. That's the Sutton Motors entry. David Selden and Phil Ward in the Gemini.
I was very fortunate that your Channel 7 director broke in and told me that there was a bad accident on. So I was able to get on the brakes and also get my arm out the window and slow some of the other cars. What is KB limping back, obviously.
Alan, can you come back?
So Kevin Bartlett is involved as well in car 9. You can see there as they're being held back.
Okay.
That's in the crowd. People shocked by the confusion of the scene there. The track is completely blocked. We have Alan Grice in car 44 talking there.
No worries, mate. How's your leg, all right? How's your leg?
I think I broke something
in the hip. A bit of a bump on the hip.
Yeah, I braced myself.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Kevin Bartlett, of course, has an artificial hip joint from a previous accident in Alola. He suffered an accident in New Zealand. Thinks he may have broken the joint in his hip.
KB's okay. He said he's... He's bruised his hip on the hip brace in his car.
Can
he's,
you?
He's okay. It doesn't appear to me as though anybody else has damaged it. When I arrived on the scene, there wasn't a great deal of activity trying to get people out of motor cars, so I can only assume that they've all safely got out. There's the beginnings of the normal mass confusion occurring, or is about to occur up here. We've got people starting to come over the fence, police officials running around, don't appear to have a leader at the moment. The drivers have certainly decided that the rotor race is finished. I think the rules will say there'll have to be a restart, I'm not quite sure. I'm quite sure Frank will be going through the rule book back in the pits to sort out whether there should be a restart of the race. Kevin did tell me that his car is in a very bad way. I can't see any damage from my end, but now, it's obviously on the front left corner.
Now, is that Kevin we can see with Chris Cole helping, or Chris Gibson helping him there, just walking along? I think Chrissy Gibson on the right, giving her arm around Kevin Butler, and that'll be good news for her children at home.
Well, for the first time in this race, Alan, in the history of it, we have the pits absolutely bare and all the cars parked on top of the mountain.
There's Kevin Bartlett's Chevy Camaro, which was an early leader of the race, doing sensational times. Out of the race.
Yeah, there's the front of KB's car.
Yes.
The front of Chris's car.
We've just passed David Silver's car.
Salika, yep. Bob Morris. I'd say there's probably, just doing a quick sum in my head, there's probably something in the order of $450,000 to $500,000 worth of damage just sitting back there. It's a very sad way for a thing to happen in a motor race like this. It makes no winner. It means that there's just no winner in the motor race. There may be a restart. There may be a winner declared, but unfortunately it makes it a non-race. Still, it's, every sporting event has its highs and has its lows. And, I guess we've just seen a very unfortunate low.
Well, what runs through the mind of a driver with all your concentration going on passing cars and you come around a corner and the track is blocked with wrecked cars?
Well, at the risk of sounding dramatic, you seem to spend all week here racing and you work yourself up into a sort of a state of motion to attack this thing over this long duration. And when an immense accident like that happens, and I was sort of parked at the rear of the ambulance, and there are a couple of people hurt. Kevin Bartlett was carried to the back of the ambulance, and another person was placed on a stretcher and placed in the ambulance. And as I said here now talking to you, I was starting to realise that the risks that are involved in motor racing, you sort of forget. You tear around here and rush down the hill at 140 miles an hour and forget about it. You think you're immortal, and then a thing like that happening, and especially such a incredible thing, you know, the whole of the Bathurst 1000 has been stopped by an accident. It's unbelievable. And because I'm sitting here now, sort of wondering what the heck I'm doing here.
With the decision on the fate of the race from the Australian Racing Drivers Club, Ivan Stibbard.
And the regulations say that after 60% of the distance has been covered and the red flag is used, the race must be declared. We cannot have a restart.
Well, that means that Dick Johnson is the winner under those conditions?
Yes, he has.
It had to happen in such a way that it never got right to the very finish. But, however, at least we made some impression in the last 20 laps or so, and I really think that the car possibly would have made it to the end because we had no problems at all. Everything was really cruising well. The old Ford, she never stopped.
Little did we know Dick Johnson's win in the 1981 James Hardie 1000 would elevate him to superstar status among motor racing's faithful. That was the start of a truly magnificent career. Hope you enjoyed this week's Mountain Memories. Join me next time as we continue to profile a national icon, the great race at Bathurst.